About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host, and this evening we have really big dogs to show you. Dogs that could, if needed, pull Santa's sleigh. So I think we'll talk first to Carol, and Carol has Greater Swiss Mountain Dogs. Long title. Our other guest is Angela, and she has the hairy ones, which are Bernese Mountain Dogs, but we're going to talk to Carol and Stephanie first. So tell us a little bit about Greater Swiss Mountain Dogs. They look basically all the same. They're black dogs with brown and white. Are they the only color it comes in?
There have been some litters of blue, palomino, and actually a rust color, but they're not acknowledged as far as the standard is concerned.
Okay.
But they're beautiful dogs.
Okay. Palomino then is yellow?
You're correct.
What are the other markings then? Is it white?
They have white, palomino, and it kind of is mixed in with the rust. But they're beautiful, but they're not our standard, so they can't be shown in AKC confirmation events.
Right. And the blue would be, you know, the blue is just a dilute black.
Correct, but they're beautiful.
Yeah. Well, I like the more striking colors, of course, which is, I think this is very striking, the black, rust, and white, but.
We do, too.
I guess so. That's why you have two of those, huh?
Right.
Now, where did this dog actually originate? In Switzerland?
Correct.
Okay.
Back in 1908, Dr. Albert, is it Heim?
Heim.
Was at a dog show in Switzerland, and the long-haired Bernese Mountain Dogs were being judged, and he saw this short-haired, what they call Bernese Mountain Dog, and he said, this dog really needs to be acknowledged. So that's actually how they got founded, at a dog show in Sweden, Switzerland in 1908.
Yeah. How about that?
Yeah. So.
Well, I know Dr. Irwin was one, he lived in Sinking Spring, and he was really one of the pioneers that brought the breed over.
Correct.
His wife was Swiss.
Correct.
And she had grown up with the dogs.
Correct. I think there was also a kennel in Indiana that also had them here in the United States and then started the breeding program.
Right. But when you think about it, the dog was actually started here in Berks County, which I think is really amazing.
Yes,
I think that's amazing. That's really interesting. So why were these dogs bred? What are they supposed to do, or what did they do?
Go ahead. Their job was to be general all-purpose farm dogs.
Okay.
They did some what they call drafting, which is pulling carts. Mm-hmm. They would often pull little milk wagons. They would herd.
Okay.
If a farmer had animals to take to the market, they would do some herding.
Okay.
So just a basic all-purpose farm dog.
Huh.
And there is a mastiff type dog that actually goes back to Roman times in the first century when the Romans were taking over Europe. The Romans took dogs with them.
Yes.
And they had a mastiff type dog called a Milosian.
Mm-hmm.
And it's believed that this breed either descended from the Milosian or perhaps interbred with some local Swiss dogs that were already there to create this breed.
Right.
By the as you know, Carol related about the dog show in 1908. By the beginning of the 20th century, this breed was almost extinct.
Oh my word!
Because of the trains That's and other mechanized transportation.
Yeah, you didn't need the dog.
Right, they lost their job, mm-hmm. and you no longer saw them. And this Dr. Heim recognized this short-haired dog as a dog that was known sometimes as the butcher's dog.
Wow.
And realized that it was probably one of the few left. And actually, the entire breed as it stands today is based on 7 individuals.
Oh my God!
That he and another man were able to locate, and they started to breed.
Wow!
But there's only really 7 individuals in the base of this entire breed.
Amazing, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Amazing, isn't it? Yeah, I think a lot of the dogs in Europe, the mastiff type dogs, the big ones, were part of the Molossians.
Mm-hmm.
The St. Bernard, the Newfoundland,
yes.
All of those type of dogs were all descended from
right.
what the Romans brought along with them mm-hmm. through the mountains.
Mm-hmm. You're correct.
But, yeah, how about that? How popular is this breed?
Sometimes a little bit too popular. So, you know, we try to keep the breeding program, you know, breeding quality dogs that
mm-hmm.
have their health clearances, so we get healthy puppies that will make great pets for families. We really try to keep a handle on the breeding
mm-hmm,
process
mm-hmm.
because you just don't want to breed indiscriminately.
Right. Well, I think also with big breeds, you have the hip problems
mm-hmm.
more so than, you know, most of the medium to small breeds.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to have, what else are they prone to other than the hip dysplasia?
Well, the big dog problems, mm-hmm, which of course
mm-hmm.
are the hips.
Mm-hmm.
Occasionally there could be a grade 1 elbow,
okay.
and sometimes that's created by a possible injury. We don't see a lot of that.
Okay.
Their eyes are very good. Occasional premature eye problems, but you know, basically the hips is what we worry
yeah.
a lot about to
yeah.
make sure that they're nice and clear and
okay.
Nice and tight, I should say,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and have no degenerative joint diseases in their hips. So that's
okay.
why we get the x-rays of the
okay.
hips, elbows, and have eyes checked.
But I think
breeding.
A big problem in this breed, I'm not quite sure about the Berners, but I know in this breed it's bloat is a big...
It can be an issue,
mm-hmm.
and they're actually doing some studying on that. They seem to feel that there's a possibility that the bloat could be inherited from certain pedigrees of Swissies.
I would definitely believe
mm-hmm.
that. I would definitely believe that. For the studio audience who doesn't know what bloat is, most people know what it is because a lot of the deep-chested breeds do have this problem. What happens is the stomach is suspended between the body somehow. It's suspended there. And it flips. And when it flips, of course, the stomach gas that would be passed out as the food is digesting is stuck. So the gas starts to build up in the stomach, which, you know, if you've had too much soda, you know how you feel all bleep. Right. Well, that's exactly what happens to the dog, except that they cannot get rid of the gas. So it just keeps blowing up and blowing up and blowing up and constricting the blood vessels. And actually, I guess it's probably fairly quickly, death occurs like within maybe 20 minutes?
Well, if you catch it in time.
Right, if you catch
know,
it in time, yeah, it can be corrected.
Remedied, but.
And a lot of times, vets will tax the stomach if
correct.
You have a line that, or a dog that's more prone to bloat, they will actually tack the stomach to the walls
mm-hmm.
so that it doesn't flip over.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm pretty sure death is fairly quick
quickly.
If you don't catch it.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Correct.
So it's another problem that you may want to think about. Somebody doesn't like the collar. Actually, that's a puppy, right?
This is
that's
a puppy.
Oh, that's the puppy.
That's Junior. He's 5 months old, and Joy is just over a year.
Okay. Now, for you people who were thinking of getting this as a breed, that is a puppy. Have Junior stand up. so we can see what size Junior actually is.
Come on.
Junior weighs what? About?
Oh, he could be about
70, 80 yes. pounds at least?
Yes.
Okay. Now that is a 5 month old puppy.
Hey, buddy.
Not exactly something that you'd want to carry around. Obviously, training is a must.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But the temperament on these guys seems really good.
It's very good. That I breed for temperament.
Okay.
Of course, the clearances are important.
Mm-hmm.
And I do some showing and confirmation, which is important also. But, you know, you want these guys to have a great temperament. So I think it's important in any breed,
yes.
you know, to have that, regardless large dogs, mm-hmm. small dogs. Mm-hmm.
But especially with a giant breed like this, you know, they are big, they are going to get, you know, what does she go?
I'm going to say Joy is about 105
okay.
pounds.
Okay, so the males top out what, at about maybe 120, 130?
I have a boy at home that I believe is about 130 pounds,
okay.
and he's just about a year and a half old, so
okay.
they can get quite large.
Yes, yes. So with a dog that size, you know, you have to, you really have to worry about temperament, because something
yes.
that size can take you down in a hurry.
That's correct.
Even by mistake.
And they have.
And they have. Are they easy to train?
They have a little bit of a stubborn streak to them. They're a little bit more, they're independent, not quite as obedient as the Labrador Retriever, for
okay.
instance.
Okay.
But we do have people that get their obedience titles,
mm-hmm.
tracking titles,
mm-hmm.
and obedience titles. And I think once you know, understand how to train them obedience-wise, it's a snap.
Okay.
But, you
okay.
know, getting through to them can be a little difficult at times.
And I think we do have a picture of some of the dogs carting. I think we have a picture of two dogs pulling a cart. When I said they could help Santa, this is what I was referring to. See? There's two dogs in harness pulling, they're in tandem pulling a cart. So that's what they actually did as farm dogs. You would have one or two dogs depending on the load that they would be carrying to market. And that's what they were used as, you know, the draft dogs carrying the milk, the meat, cheeses, whatever mm-hmm. else they needed to carry. Even sometimes the children rode in the carts.
Mm-hmm.
So this was a job that these dogs were bred to do. The Bernese Mountain Dog was also bred to do the same kind of job. But I thought it would be interesting to see a picture of, you know, actually what a cart is. Exercise. Do they require a lot of exercise?
They like to run short distances, I think, and come back to you usually.
Okay. Walk around the block would be sufficient.
My guys like to just kind of run out full tilt and do a couple of circles and whoops, come back. Usually, they're not because they're not sporting dogs. They want to do a job and they want to work.
Okay.
So you know when they pull a cart, they're ready. But
okay.
as
okay.
far as being super duper active. I don't think
they'd be just as content to lay in
absolutely.
Front of the fire as
yep.
to
or
okay.
on your lap or
on your lap. Okay, 130 pounds on your lap.
Oh yeah,
a little bit of weight. Okay, right now I think we're going to take a break and we will be right back and talk about the Bernese Mountain Dog.
You're watching All About Dogs on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other stories about animals and pets, go to www.bctv.org. All About Dogs is underwritten by the Berks County Kennel Club and by Berks Dog Training Club. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
And we're back. Now we'll talk to Angela and Joe about their, well, Angela is going to do the talking, about their Bernese Mountain Dogs. And this breed looks very similar to the Greater Swiss Mountain Dog, except this one is really hairy. So can we see the Bernese Mountain Dog? Can somebody get a shot of the puppies and this this moose of a dog, which we will have Stan. Those are the puppies. We'll get a shot of the big guy, which is what they mature into. There you go. And he goes to about maybe 150?
No, he's actually 115.
100? Really?
Yes.
It must be all the hair.
A lot of it is the hair.
Wow.
They're a little bit smaller, actually, than the Greater Swiss.
Oh, my.
And the average male is probably more like 100 pounds.
How about that?
He's a little bit large.
Yeah.
And he's probably a little heavy right now, so he probably is 120, but when he's good weight, he's 115.
Oh, my word.
And your average female is probably 80 pounds.
Oh, my gosh. That's little.
Well, it's not little, but...
Well, when you're talking about 130 pounds,
that's smaller.
Gee, I just expected they would be way more than that.
I believe what makes them seem way more than that is all the hair.
Yeah, I can imagine. Yeah. So do you have a lot of grooming with these guys?
I have owned German Shepherds in the past, and I can honestly say I've had more hair with German Shepherds.
Okay.
You do have a lot of grooming twice a year.
Okay.
In the springtime, they'll blow their coat, and in the fall.
Uh-huh.
And at that point, you have a lot of hair.
Okay.
Generally speaking, in the summer and in the winter, they'll hold their coat.
Okay.
So I'm not diminishing the amount of hair
everything is relative.
Everything is relative, exactly. But I have had dogs that I've had
much more hair
with consistently.
Okay. So then these guys, you just need to
groom them. You definitely, I mean, if you're negligent in your grooming, you're going to have a hair issue. You've got to get that undercoat out, and you've got to,
And I would assume around the softness around the ears, you would have to brush maybe at least once a week. I would think you would need to brush the dog itself once a week.
Generally speaking, I brush them out really well once a week.
Okay.
When they're blowing their coat, I probably do it 3 times a week.
Mm-hmm.
And you trim around the ears so that you don't get mats.
Yes,
and you trim around the feet.
Yeah. But you can see they look very similar to the Greater Swiss Mountain Dog. And probably at some point they might have even been, like Carol said,
they were
both shown in the same class, but
At one point, I believe they were one breed.
Yeah. And I'm not quite sure what would have been mixed with it, but they're colored very similar to a Rottweiler without the, the white.
And I believe the Rottweiler was probably also part of this.
The whole thing, because they came from Germany as well, so. Right.
These are actually in the Bern area of Switzerland.
Right.
Is where they...
originated,
so to speak, or were recognized and then actually bred as a breed.
Yeah. I wonder if, because they did come in I was going to say the St. Bernards, but the St. Bernards are all brown. You'd have some of the black markings.
Well,
but
once in a while you do get a copper color. They call it copper.
Okay.
Bernese Mountain Dog, and it's a recessive gene that will come out. And
it's
the same as the Greater Swiss. It's not
recognized.
Mm-hmm, it's not part of the standard, but it does come out, and occasionally you get over white puppies where the whole front will be white.
Oh,
you'll have a collar kind of like a Saint Bernard.
Oh my goodness. Hi, kid. They are so cute. How old are these? Now we saw the size of the 5-month-old.
These puppies are, she's actually 4 months old and she's a little over 3. They're 3 weeks apart, these two girls.
Okay.
And I'd say this breed is a little bit, is not quite the couch potato that the Greater Swiss is.
Okay.
My dogs, that's the one fallacy. I see it on the internet all the time that, this is a non-active dog and, it's just really happy and people get them. And then they say, but this dog wants to do things. And the dog, it's a working dog, and people should keep that in their mind.
Uh-huh,
and working dogs either need a job or at least regular, good physical activity. Mm-hmm. And walking this dog around the block just won't do it.
Okay. So then you wouldn't suggest this for, say, an older couple?
If it was an active older couple, I don't see any problem with it. If the couple likes to walk and likes to do things and likes to engage with their dog, it's not the same type of activity level that say a
Dalmatian
exactly, or even a Labrador would have.
Okay.
But it's definitely not like a bulldog where it's just happy
to lay there.
Yeah, especially the puppies, you know, and even my older dogs. I have older dogs that, you know, I take them for good walks every day, and they run and run and run and run.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Well, I think every dog needs exercise. You know, it's what the heck? Would they make good apartment dogs? They're not barkers. Well, neither are these guys. Oh, they are barkers.
Oh yes.
Oh.
They announce.
Everybody.
Mine. Some of mine are barkers and some of them are not. So.
Oh, no, I wouldn't have expected that. I would have expected an alert bark and
right.
You know, that
when
was
somebody,
it.
When somebody
bark,
comes,
somebody's here.
When somebody comes, yes.
They will alert you when someone
they will alert
is
you
here
when someone
at your
comes. Absolutely.
Residence.
And
okay.
If you think about it, that's what they were used for at the farm. The farmer was busy and he needed somebody to let him know somebody's here. So they're not aggressive, but they will alert you when somebody comes.
Okay.
And they won't stop until you realize that this person is there and you recognize this.
Okay. Because I was thinking of like an apartment. Would they make good apartment dogs? Either one? No? She's saying no with the Swissie.
I would think it would not be an ideal situation.
Okay.
For the dog. These dogs like to be outside.
Okay.
They like the cold and they like to be outside. Mm-hmm. And
because I know some of the giant breeds really are quite content to be in an apartment. Mm-hmm. You know, they really could care less that they don't have the activity level.
I actually think that the Mastiff probably has a lower activity level than these guys.
These were
more, way more active than
is
led on to. They really are active.
Can we get Louie to wake up? Okay, there. Hi, Louie. You can see. He looks like a big dog. You know, he looks like he weighs way more than 120 pounds. He just looks big to me. A lot of dog. You gotta want a lot of dog. Do they drool?
No. They're dry mouthed.
Wow.
Bernese Mountain Dogs are dry mouthed, and I believe Greater Swiss are dry mouthed.
That's what she's saying. They're dry mouthed, which is good.
Which is very good.
Right.
Which is very good. It's a, they were also used. It was the same, basically the same history. They're also used for pulling carts.
Okay.
Louis actually helps me feed my horses every day,
that's
a
his
cart.
Job.
And I put a bale of hay in the back of the cart, and we schlep through the woods and down into the field, and he stands there and waits, and I throw the hay all over the field, take the cart back up to the house, and he does this every day.
So now, the medical problems would be hip dysplasia?
Hip dysplasia is...
And with bloat, are they...
Bloat is an issue.
They don't have eye problems, though.
No.
Neither breed has eye problems.
No, not really.
Not really. Not like some of the collie breeds with the PRA.
We have them. We have, if you're breeding the dogs, you should definitely have your
eyes
checked.
Sure,
and
sure.
We have the hearts checked, and we have the hips and the elbows.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And they do have a hemophilia that runs in the breed, but if you... At this point, because of the breeder's diligence in checking for this hemophilia, it's pretty much bred out.
Good.
Which is a good
thing. Yes, it certainly is a good thing, because I know that it's widespread in Dobermans. You know, Dobermans
exact same von Wildebrandt that the Dobermans.
Von Wildebrandt, right. Now, are these guys easy to train?
They're fairly easy. Yeah, they're a little... I wouldn't say they're difficult. Some of them are a little bit comedic. I mean, I have had them where they've been really simple, and he has a little bit of a comedy streak, so he likes attention.
The entertainer,
exactly. But when I'm at home and I need him to truck that hay out and there's no audience, he does his job, and it doesn't matter what squirrel runs in front of him or what's going on. He's on a mission and he's doing his job. So
very good.
They you know, if they really have a real job, they do it.
So how popular is this breed?
It's getting a little bit too popular.
Really? Hey, you wouldn't think that, you know, a big hairy dog would be, you know, people don't have mansions, they have small backyards.
Well, I think what happens is people see this really cute little puppy.
Yes.
With
and
all
they
this
grow up.
Fur. Mm-hmm. And they think, oh, and then they read the little blip in on the internet that says this dog is for everyone, mm-hmm. and this dog is very low level mm-hmm. of activity. And they think, oh, I just would like
right,
one.
Right.
And then they get it home and they realize that the level of activity is probably a little bit higher than mm-hmm. the internet. Mm-hmm. claimed it mm-hmm. was, and that this little puppy that's supposed to lay around all day and look cute is chewing up my wall.
Well, they are cute. They are very striking. They're very mm-hmm. striking dogs. They really are.
But given the right person and the right situation,
it is the perfect dog. That's exactly right.
Yeah, it's
and
the
for
perfect
obviously
dog.
For you it's, and for yeah. Carol and Steph, mm-hmm. they are mm-hmm. These are the perfect
it
dogs.
Is
of course,
the
they don't
dog.
Like as much hair as you like. Well, thank you very much. And before we end our program this evening, if you are thinking about getting a puppy for Christmas, please think twice. Christmas is not exactly the best time to get a puppy. First of all, you're going to be too busy. If you are having the family over for Christmas dinner, who's going to be taking that puppy out because it's going to need to go outside? Who's going to feed it? Who's going to clean up after it if it has an accident in the house? The Christmas tree, the lights, if the puppy bites the cord, you have an electrocuted puppy. If they get into the glass or plastic ornaments, you're going to have to rush the dog to emergency because that will cut up the intestines. So there are table scraps. You're going to have a dog with diarrhea or vomiting. So there are all really wonderful reasons why not to get a puppy at Christmas. If you want to get a puppy in that time frame, I would, especially if you're getting it for your children, I would get a book, a collar, a leash, a dog bowl, and present that to the kids. Then let them go with you to the breeders to select the puppy that they want. I wouldn't want somebody picking out a puppy for me. I want to pick out my own puppy. So if you're going to gift me, I want to go and pick out the one that I want, not the one that you want. So a good reason not to get a puppy at Christmas, but it's mainly because it's just way too busy a time. Plus, it's cold outside. Who's going to go out at 2 o'clock in the morning? So that's our program for this evening. Hope you all have a very, very nice holiday season. And until next month, good night.